The environmental movement has a long history here in this country. It's been a force for good, for a safer, healthier America. And as a people, we want and need that economic growth. But now we must also expect environmental responsibility and respect the natural world. And this will demand a national sense of commitment, a new ethic of conservation. And I reject the notion that sound ecology and a strong economy are mutually exclusive. And I'm committed to see that coming generations receive the natural legacy they deserve.
Okay. Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for giving us the opportunity to come talk to you today. First of all, I am glad that your generation is paying a lot of attention to climate change issues. You know, we're living in a time when it's actually kind of hard to tell the difference between a fact and a not fact. And we have a lot of people sort of making it hard for science to actually be part of conversations. And we've gotten ourselves in kind of a mess by letting politics solve problems.
We don't always see eye to eye, do we, Newt?
No, but we do agree our country must take action to address climate change.
That was dumb.
Were you being held hostage right now?
No, just dumb.
A lot of it's a hoax.
Hold on.
Tell us how to use the science to actually change public consensus.
Look, it's not just CNN. It's the liberal media culture.
I mean, climate change is a religious belief for people who think they're too smart for religion.
La la, we're going down a rabbit hole. I want to talk about the solution.
The day two politicians are arguing about whether science is true, it means nothing gets done. Nothing.
There's no doubt that politics is playing a major role here, and I don't understand why, because this is not a Democratic or a Republican issue. It shouldn't have anything to do with politics at all. We don't have a science problem, we have a communication problem. Working with young people is very important. Many of them, I think, are getting very anxious about the climate crisis and worried about whether or not there is a solution. What I'm trying to do is to help them see that they do have a role in the solution and that there is a path forward.
We need to understand what kind of uncertainty we're looking at and make sure that all of the Science Foundation gets into the policy that's going to be written within the next couple of years.
Make everything a lot more condensed and visual.
I think we do need to do everything we can to make people feel included.
Looking at the current political climate, you really need a mentor to guide yourself through the process.
It's hard to describe her in just a few terms. She has so many resources and so many connections.
So white is good.
She's not your typical college professor.
I'll even let you use my White House glasses.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah.
I haven't heard too much about her White House experience other than the White House wine glasses.
I spoke at a high school just a couple of weeks ago, and all the students wanted to be adaptation professionals. How did you even know that was a thing?
You quickly develop a relationship with her in one way or another.
Coming into this field is a place of frustration, but it's also, I feel like I can make a difference here.
Being a woman in science, you stand on the shoulders of women who've really pushed the boundaries of the fields further. And Kathy has paved the way for careers like mine.
I worked as a water manager for the state of Arizona for almost 25 years. From that place, I became part of the community that looks at climate issues. I arrived in Washington, D.C. in December of 2009. I think people have this idea of how romantic it must be to work in the White House, and I would have to say that there was very little romance.
All we know about climate science and what we don't know.
I was asked to do a number of things. I was the director of the National Climate Assessment, but also the lead policy advisor for water and climate adaptation for the president's science advisor. So kind of a long title. This was an incredible gift to be able to serve my country and to be able to deal with an issue that I really cared about a lot. There were many times from an emotional perspective that I wondered if it was worth it, because I did have to fight to make things happen. And I'm not absolutely certain I could have done it for more than 4 years, because it was starting to take a little bit of a toll. But ultimately, I don't really feel that I have a choice, because I have children and I have grandchildren and I care about the future of the world, and all of these things are at risk. If we don't do something, we will have a much more challenging time adapting in the future.
This is something that I can really plug into, that I really care about, and that I think I can move it forward.
Well, I think it's actually really a gift to be able to talk about both science and people. That's incredibly challenging. We do need to have the technical background that both of you have and understand the policy context. And very few people know how to do that. So will we get back to a place where science is squarely where it belongs, which is as the foundation for democracy?
Like 2020 is at least as big of an issue for us as 2026, because our project is actually...
So before I do a PowerPoint presentation, I can't even see all of you. Do you have any questions at all? Yes.
What do you think is the best thing that our generation and future generations can do to help mitigate or solve the effects of climate change?
I think the most important thing is actually asking questions and being aware and vote. Good leadership is the only thing standing between us and solutions right now. The question is really, how much will we lose before the pendulum swings back again?
I'm just trying to do the right thing.
If we don't have access to facts, we don't have access to a reasonable democracy.